The biggest mistake I see people make on their self-sufficiency journey is spending too much time and energy trying to grow as much food as possible. And in this video, I'm going to explain why. To keep things nice, clear, and simple, I'm going to define self-sufficiency as growing the vast majority of your annual fruit, vegetable, and herb needs. And everything in this video is going to be extremely useful, even if you don't want to be fully self-sufficient, because the same principles can be applied to any scale. Firstly, depending on if you've watched this channel before or not, I want to remind you or introduce you to the idea of part-time self-sufficiency. So this means either choosing to grow a particular crop that is going to last you over a set period of time. For example, being self-sufficient in homegrown onions all the way through autumn, or it can mean choosing a dedicated time, for example, weekends, which is when you can only eat produce that has come from your garden. The reason why this works is that you're not being 100% strict. You don't have to follow that rule day in and day out, but you are setting yourself a challenge that when you accomplish that challenge, you feel a really deep sense of satisfaction. One danger of being really strict with what you can and can't eat is that it can take the fun away from it. And I think it's okay that we all treat ourselves from time to time. I think instead we should look at what kind of techniques and strategies we can use to empower ourselves to make the biggest possible difference. Instead of going all out with trying to be self-sufficient, which can very quickly lead to burnout, by embracing part-time self-sufficiency, what you're doing is giving yourself the space and the flexibility to see what is possible. And this is going to allow you to make far more informed decisions to then influence the approach that you want to take in the future. I think it's vital that we know what is realistic when it comes to self-sufficiency. For example, you could have grown loads of chickpeas, but then spend hours shelling them for arguably not much in return. One thing we forget to do as growers and gardeners is create a true value for the time that we spend in the garden. If we're going down the path of self-sufficiency, we've got to be honest and understand and accept that time is our biggest limitation. And I think instead of looking at how to grow as much food as possible, we need to look at how can we be more clever with our time, and also how can we look at alternatives. So for example, instead of growing chickpeas to make hummus, I could make a hummus alternative out of white beans, which on an hour by hour basis, I'd be able to shell so many more white beans than chickpeas in terms of weight. And you've really got to think very carefully about if I've got a finite number of hours to try and be self-sufficient in, which we all have, there's only so many hours in a day, then how can I make the most of each hour? Self-sufficiency really shouldn't be about working harder. It has to be about how you can work smarter with what you have available. If we're looking at self-sufficiency, it comprises of two pillars. You've got the growing pillar and then you've got the eating pillar. Very often there's no kind of proper marriage between the growing and the eating. We grow a lot of food and we're like, what do we do with this all? And then we're trying to work out how we can preserve it, how we can eat it, how we can enjoy it. I honestly believe that if you spent more time researching new recipes for certain ingredients that you grow a lot of or you have available, and start creating a really comprehensive library for every single ingredient, then that alone is going to really make your self-sufficiency journey suddenly become much easier. Instead of trying to make sure that, oh, I need 6 plum tomatoes every single week, what you're doing is finding really exciting and delicious ways of eating whatever is seasonal. I could spend all of my summer preserving stuff ready for winter and then spring next year, but I don't want to do that. I want to be able to enjoy my summer, and I know that I have to make sacrifices. There are sacrifices involved in self-sufficiency. So instead of looking at how I can grow enough to follow kind of a carbon copy of every single month of needing X amount of tomatoes, X amount of potatoes, for example, Instead, I want to make the most of what is available in the garden at a specific point in time during the growing season. And a really easy way of approaching this is to have the principle of cook what is in the garden. The only limitation to this method is creativity within the kitchen. But fortunately, the great thing about basically everything that you grow is that there are so many ways to cook it, to enjoy it, to pair with other ingredients and flavors and textures. What you need is sources of solid recipes and inspiration and information. So as well as my blog Farmer and Chef, which I do with my colleague Sam Cooper, for the last few months I've been making the most of Readly, who are today's sponsors, for finding the source of inspiration from food and cooking magazines. Now, I think the best way to describe Readly is an all-you-can-eat buffet for magazines that you can also share with all your family. One account gives you 5 different users. So for finding inspiration with recipes and ideas and ways of using your harvest from the garden, they have a ton of food and drink magazines. My favorite is the Good Food magazine, and I love being able to look through and get ideas for like different curries I can make, different desserts, different soups. The other thing is that it also has all of the back issues. So I can look back at what kind of recipes they had last autumn and winter, so I can prepare some ideas in advance, ready for when those particular crops come into season. And of course, a big part of being self-sufficient is all of the growing and the gardening that's involved. So they've got popular magazines such as Kitchen Garden magazine and Grow Your Own. One of my favorite things about Readly is that there's a bookmark function. So if I ever see a recipe or a garden idea, I can bookmark it there and then, so I can always come back to it when I need to reference it. If you want to make the most of this great resource, you can do for free today. You can use my link down below in the video description. You'll get 6 weeks of Readly access for free, and it's only £7.99 a month after that. So now is the ideal time, now that the garden has settled down, to start getting loads of ideas and inspiration for the rest of autumn, winter, and ready for next year. Earlier today, I was thinking, how can self-sufficiency work with permaculture? And then I remembered the principle of work with nature, not against nature. And I thought, it's perfect. When it comes to self-sufficiency, work with the seasons, not against the seasons. Embrace all of the opportunities, but also the limitations that seasons have to offer. For example, wintertime. Wintertime is great. I've got a lot of free time, so I can prepare recipes, I can look at ideas, I can look at how I can best preserve tomatoes or carrots or anything like that. So during the busier times of the year, I have all that information ready to go. I can just implement them straight away and make the most of my time. And then, of course, in winter, in my climate, I have a lot of food in the ground that can just be perfectly happy in the ground, and I can just come and harvest when I need it. One limitation of winter is that you might not have as many fresh herbs or fruit. So you got to think, okay, how can I prepare in advance? For example, how can I preserve herbs ready for winter time? And then you could think about summertime. Okay, in summer, it's great because I've got so much food coming out. I don't actually have that much time. So I really need to, as much as possible, eat whatever is freshest, because unlike winter, where food will quite happily just sit in the ground, summer has a much faster turnaround. So that's really where you've got to eat what's in the garden first and then preserve second. I've been thinking a lot about self-sufficiency recently because, like everyone else, my biggest limitation is time. For example, a YouTube video takes me around 24 hours to create, and that's excluding all the uploading, answering comments and all of that. And then obviously I've got books and other projects to write and to work on. And so the biggest shift for me in terms of moving towards self-sufficiency, which I'm not 100% in, and I don't ever want to be 100% in, because I'll miss a lot of things, you know, and that's okay. But the single biggest difference has been embracing what is in the garden. Suddenly having this arsenal or this library and toolkit of loads of different recipes that I've been collecting and researching, suddenly it makes it a lot more easy. For example, for many crops which I would maybe get a little bit bored of eating, I suddenly get excited about them, and then I start thinking, well, I've learned all these things. Can I maybe take some ideas for how I cook other crops that are similar and apply these principles to this? And more often than not, I'm really pleasantly surprised with the outcomes. I've been harking on a little bit about seasonality, so I want to give you a different aspect of self-sufficiency to start exploring and considering, and that's the aspect of staples and kind of flavor profiles. We're limited to the climate that we grow in, and we can use spaces like this polycrub to make it more favorable for certain conditions and certain plants. For example, my tomatoes, which is coming to the end of the season, but they wouldn't be able to do nearly as well if I didn't have this space. But even having a space like this, I know that I'd struggle quite a bit to grow something like lemons. But something that I've been researching quite a bit is these kind of families, for example, the citrus family, and that there are actually different varieties or species within a plant family that are suitable for different climates. For example, yuzu, which is another type of citrus, is more suitable for a slightly colder climate. So even though I probably wouldn't risk growing lemons, I'm about to buy a couple of yuzu trees or yuzu plants to grow in here in containers to see if I can grow a citrus here. And then it means that I'm growing something that has a similar profile to lemon or lime, but it is local. It is local to me. And instead of having to import things, because I think a big thing about self-sufficiency is also reducing food miles, I want to be clever about finding specific plants and specific varieties that I can maybe kind of push the boundaries a bit and grow in this climate. Now you can kind of use this technique and go a little bit wacky, and things like spaghetti squash is a kind of a pasta alternative, a gluten-free pasta alternative that you can grow, and that will last until at least June or July next year. In fact, all of my spaghetti squash now I'm saving for the hungry gap. Or you can look at things like, okay, you like rice. Is it worth, if you have the land, exploring a way of growing something like wild rice? How possible might that be? Yes, of course, projects like this will probably take up more time than you would probably want to take up if you're just growing a normal crop. But on the flip side, it's something really exciting. You're doing something you've never done before. You're experimenting, and you all know how much I love experimentation in the garden. And having a project where you don't really know how it's going to turn out, and then sometimes you're pleasantly surprised, then that is worth the satisfaction. And then you can do it again year after year, improving your efficiency to be just as efficient as you would growing your main crops. And so what I want you to understand from this is that you can have similar related crops that grow in very different climates, but it means that you can have similar flavors. And it's really exciting and empowering being able to see all of these varieties and plants that actually hold potential. And I think we have the ideal opportunity now to really explore that and share our findings with other gardeners or other homesteaders, so we can all help one another within our growing area become more self-sufficient. Just as a side note, another plant that I think I'll be able to grow successfully here if I do it right is stevia, which is an excellent natural sugar alternative. I think in order to be successful on your self-sufficiency journey, you've got to pick your battles carefully. You've got to choose things that either excite you the most or hold the most potential, and really hone in on those and get those to a point where you're really satisfied. You're like, great, I found the process, I found the system. Let's now look at a new aspect. Let's get that to a point of satisfaction. Great, I've got that banked ready. Let's look at the next one. And so what you're always doing is making lots and lots of small improvements that are going to lead up to big changes. And of course, one thing I haven't mentioned is that you need something to measure what success is to you. So you just need to find out what your end self-sufficiency goal is, so you can always know where you're heading towards, and you can compare every single growing season to see if we're getting slightly closer or slightly further away. Winter is quickly approaching, which is great. I've got some more time on my hands. I can focus on a little bit more preserving, for example, dehydrating the peppers in the polycrub. But we've got to be cautious about the period after winter. It's called the hungry gap. So when the winter crops finished around March, and then up until kind of mid to late June, you have this gap where there isn't much fresh. The summer crops aren't ready yet. And it's really challenging, especially if you're wanting to be self-sufficient. So in order to have the most productive hungry gap possible, watch this video here, because it's going to show you the most productive crops that you can grow and eat and enjoy during the hungry gap. And that alone is going to make such a big difference to helping you get ever closer to your self-sufficiency goals. And don't forget to enjoy 2 free months at Readly.